You know it's not good when you're sitting at the top, you're contemplating, and everybody's running over with their cell phones, and they're all going, yeah, yeah.
I'm relieved, I'm excited. It's been a long 3 or 4 months prepping race cars to finally get to this point.
We had done all the pre-running. The car was working well. We were ready mentally and physically.
It was a certain amount of weight off my shoulders, and yet we still had certainly the hardest part ahead of us.
It's time to get in the race car, it's time to haul ass. I was playing it safe, not taking any really big risks. But I got through the first couple people in the first rock section, and then as soon as we hit the desert, I was out front by about race mile 3 or 4.
Derek West probably put down 30 or 40 cars pretty quickly. I wasn't held up and we were able to just run. It took a little bit to get in the groove. Wanted to make sure we just got out, we got through. We knew our car was good in the desert and we knew together we were comfortable at speed. It's one hand in the wheel, one hand in the gear shift, well into the triple digits.
My car is not set up for the desert. It's more rock car than it is desert car. So that one was rough. It was seeing guys racing, seeing guys braking, and just, you know, trying to get through it.
After Remote Pit 1, it opens up into the fast desert sections where you can just see across for 5 miles. You can see a guy in front of you. That was really something that fired Mike and I up where, okay, we're gonna go catch that guy. You can just see miles and miles of whoops. If you can see that they're consistent, you're good. And you know, you just sort of skip across the top of them.
My car works really well in the desert, and I know it. We spent a ton of time tuning the shocks to work well in really big whoops. I was setting my own pace. I was running like 75%, not gonna make a mistake, not gonna cut a tire, and you know, just keep moving at a good pace.
I had 3 goals. One was run solid, not necessarily fast, but solid and consistent. 2, it was being conservative, you know, save the car. And 3 was finishing the race.
Anything can happen racing, period. King of the Hammers adds so many elements to it.
You feel it. You know when the motor comes apart, you know, it just starts rattling through the chassis all the way through your bones. I didn't even have any warning that the motor was getting ready to go, and when it did, it went big. It broke a rod, went through the side of the block and the oil pan, dumped oil all over the headers, and that's what caught on fire.
I remember just catching Lauren out of the corner of my eye. I can actually remember him waving at us. I remember going through my head that it was probably something more major than minor, or else I know he would have been there fixing it, tweaking it, and getting it back in the race.
I think he was probably up in the top 10 at that point. I kind of gave him a thumbs up and come on, you're up now.
Coming down back door was easier than I had anticipated. Once you're down there looking, as soon as those front tires hit, we just give it a quick stab and pulls out from underneath us. Gaining the 6 positions or so on lap 1 was a real boost for Mike and I.
We didn't have a tire issue of the four on the car for the whole day. However, the spare disappeared. It wasn't just the spare tire that was gone, the entire tire carrier was gone. We took about 20 gallons of fuel, we took some water, and we took a spare tire, and we took off. Lap two, we went back into the desert for a while, got back around the backside, hit the lake bed, and then picked our way into the rocks. They had strapped on a tire that they thought would stick around. It didn't. We actually lost it within about 2 miles. So we ran all of lap two from Maine back to 2A with no spare tire. It was a constant focus of don't get a flat, because a flat here will end the day.
Before we knew it, we had Chocolate Thunder. You can't just crawl up the first section. You have to get some momentum and just get on it. And then I see someone over here, and I know that they'd meet. Mike's in my ear going, nail it, nail it, nail it. In Upper Big Johnson, we had a good climb. I was just coming into a section. We climbed up, you know, on top. We probably have an 8, maybe a 10-foot drop. But in the race mode, you just do what you gotta do.
Are you guys okay?
That was the real turning point of the race, unfortunately. The car got hot a little later on, so we topped it up with water we had. We didn't realize it at the time. We get a vapor lock inside the cooling system from it being upside down, and it just wouldn't cool the car. We had to stop a little bit and slow down and do things, but we did get it back to the main pit. At the main pit, we did some cutting, we did some welding, we did replacement of parts, then we topped up the water once again. Still, at this point in time, we didn't realize there was an airlock. And off we went, thinking we had 7 hours. We were gonna finish. And the car quits. It took us 2 hours to wait for the parts, change the alternator, and get everything back. And Mike and I were still confident that, you know what, we could do that last lap in 5.5 hours, no problem. It didn't take us very long to realize we had the airlock, we had the heating issues, and our day just went downhill from there.
We came into Maine stoked. Our last goal of finishing King of the Hammers was ahead of us. We had 6 hours, so we were excited. We were pumped. We left lap three, did of course the first lap 1-2 segment. It was good. Running through the desert was good. I knew we had the Spooners out of limits turnoff coming. I was focused on driving. Co-driver was on the GPS, and something happened. He didn't see the trail on the GPS, and I didn't see the signs, and we flew past it.
We eventually boiled over, and then we put more water in and boiled over again. We boiled water, boiled over, and eventually we got to the point where we didn't have any water. So we would drive a couple hundred yards, shut it down. We realized at that point there's nothing we could do. Yeah, it sucked.
Slammed on the brakes, put the car in park, and I said, you know, zoom out. And we zoomed out. And there behind us, you know, 2 miles back is the red line. I turned the car around, and I heard in the back of my head, no race car shall travel backwards on the course. So we just shut it down. We weren't gonna be that team, you know, we weren't gonna be the guy traveling backwards at King of the Hammers. So we just picked our way back into town and called it a day.
Everyone comes out to win, but there's probably only 8 or 10 guys that are really capable of winning. So after that, you come out to do your very, very best. But even your best is mechanically limited and not achievable. That is the demoralizing aspect of racing. I would love to win this race, but I didn't come to win the race. I wanted to come out and do beyond my expectations. And that was cut short yesterday.
I'm still alive. The race car's not hurt that badly. It's just got to motivate you. It's got to push you harder to win the next race. Whatever I got to do, whatever it costs.
It's hard to explain what King of the Hammers is or what it's like unless you get out there and get into the rocks. You can't fight Mother Nature. And King of the Hammers is certainly a lot of that.
I've felt the gut-wrenching losses at this race. I know how hard it is to get to the finish line.
But you know what? If you don't push, you don't make it anyway. And you know what? If you're not willing to push, then you're probably not ever going to have a chance of winning that race or any other race. We didn't win. We didn't finish. We didn't do as good as we hoped. We still succeeded, and we'll be back next year to do even better.